वक्रतुंड महाकाय सूर्यकोटि समप्रभा निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा कुरु
My humble pranams at the lotus feet of our beloved Bhagavan Sri Sathya Sai Baba. Sai Ram, everyone. Welcome to the Canadian SSE Festival. How's everyone's summer vacation so far? How's everyone doing? See a lot of smiles, a lot of nodding heads. Very good. I know as everyone's been on summer vacation for about a bit over a week now, especially for our kids. Have you all been well rested, getting some of that nice long sleeping hours now that you're not in school anymore? I know I've been sleeping in a lot. If you haven't, maybe take a book out of Rogers, right? Rogers definitely enjoyed their little break yesterday. Maybe all of us didn't, but they definitely did. Before we get into today's festivities, let's start with the land acknowledgement, and then we'll go into the events for today. Sound good?
We acknowledge that the land we all call home is the traditional territory of many diverse First Nations and Indigenous peoples from across Turtle Island. We are grateful for the many gifts bestowed by this land and acknowledge the treaties and custodianship and down to the first peoples of this land.
All right, so before we get into more of the festivities for today, I'd just like to give a quick reminder to everyone. Please ensure that you've probably named yourself according to the naming convention. I'm also going to take a moment to introduce my co-emcee for today. Kishore is from the Vancouver Sci Center. Kishore is an SSE guru who has taught the Group 3 program for the past 4 years since graduating from the Vancouver SSE. This September, Kishore will be entering the education program at UBC, training to become a high school teacher. He also enjoys spending time with numerous pets, which include lizards, guinea pigs, and geckos, just to name a few. He has a lot of pets.
Hi, everybody. Good morning. So my name is Kishore, and I'm just going to introduce Anika. So Anika is a young adult from the Agincourt Sci Center in Toronto. Anika was a student at the Sethia Sci School of Canada for 8 years, as well as an SSE student at the Agincourt Sci Center for 14 years, having completed the program last summer. Currently, Anika is completing her undergraduate degree in criminology at York University and volunteers as an assistant guru in the Group 2 class at her Sci Center. A fun fact about Anika is that she has never been on an airplane before. So for those of you who are afraid of flying, hopefully you'll find a friend in Anika. So at this time, we would like to welcome our first speaker of the day, Uncle Shiva Nataraj, to begin with the opening remarks. Uncle Shiva Nataraj was born and brought up in a family devoted to Bhagavan Sri Sathya Sai Baba. Uncle Shiva has served in various leadership roles in the SSIO and is currently serving Swami as the President of National Council of Canada. Outside of the Sai fold, Uncle Shiva works as a professor of mechanical engineering at McGill University in Montreal. So at this time, we'd like to welcome Uncle Shiva to the stage.
Om Sri Sairam. And thank you so much for the wonderful and humble introduction. And I must say that Kishore, you've got, certainly sounds like you have a wonderful set of pets. We're going to have our first one who is going to, that first pet that is going to arrive in a month. And my daughter Vidya has named him Albus Dumbledore. So with love and gratitude, I offer my humble pranams at the divine lotus feet of our dearest, loving, omnipresent Lord, Bhagavan Sri Sathya Sai Baba. Dear brothers and sisters and students, living Sairams, to all of you, I'm honored and it's a privilege to speak to you all this afternoon. We're certainly all blessed and fortunate to be the contemporaries of our avatar of our age, Bhagavan Sri Sathya Sai Baba. He's not only the avatar of the age, he is our Purna avatar, our ever-present avatar in our lives with full glorious manifestations of all of his 16 attributes. He came on this earth on this to bless us, humanity, and for the redemption of all of mankind. He walked amongst us, blessing us and showering his grace and love on all our creation. He especially loved to be amongst children, and as we all have witnessed, and he will always be our internal companion. To this day, the National Education and Events team have worked tirelessly to bring this wonderful offering to all of us. In Bhagavan's words, when he addressed the devotees in particular in the year 1999, he had said these following words: "Let life be fruitful and meaningful." Life always reminds us of gifts and challenges. As a parent myself, raising children at the present age is filled with incredible amount of unmeasurable joy and happiness, but also sometimes anxiety for all that happens around us. Bhagavan teaches us to live in the world, but not off the world. And that's exactly what the SSE program is all about: building a strong character based on spirituality, so they're able to live and contribute in the world we live in. For the SSE children who are with us today, we challenge you to be the generation filled with Swami at heart and to become his messengers. Dare to be divine and live a joyous, fruitful, and a meaningful life with Bhagavan always firmly with you as a friend, as a guardian with you all the time. Today, we have a wonderful set of vibrant speakers who have become role models for their ability to steadfastly focus their work on Swami. We also have a number of national education coordinators from the US, from the UK and Australia who have joined us, apart from SSE children from these countries who are with us today. So thank you so very much to join all of us in Canada today. With that, I hope by Swami's grace that you have a wonderful Fun with Sai afternoon and for the rest of the summer. Jai Sai Ram.
Thank you, Uncle Siva, for your kind and uplifting words. Now, I don't know about all of you, but I'm really excited for what we got planned for you today. First up, we have a presentation titled "Nature is the Best Teacher" by Sister Shruti Vijayakumar. Shruti Vijayakumar is a young adult residing in Aotearoa, New Zealand. She is a South Indian Tamil descent, and she was fortunate to be born into a Sai family and is a graduate of the SSE program. Shruti has found Swami's teachings to be a big inspiration in her personal life, studies, and professional work. She especially loves experiencing God in nature and learning from nature. Professionally, Shruti works as a leadership development coach and facilitator, and as an educator in environmental sustainability. Shruti completed her MBA at the University of Oxford and has also been recognized as a global shaper by the World Economic Forum for leadership and contributions to the community. Shruti has served in various capacities in the SSSIO and is currently the Deputy International Young Adults Coordinator and a member of the Environmental Sustainability Committee. In her spare time, she loves to stargaze, hike, play the flute, and take photos. Please join me in welcoming Sister Shruti.
Sai Ram, dearest brothers, sisters, children, SSE gurus, elders, all of you that are gathered here today. It's my absolute pleasure and privilege to be with you all, so thank you for the invitation. And I wanted to first off just acknowledge all the organizers that have pulled this event together. I know there have been lots of challenges in this post-COVID world, and I'm just so inspired by the love and unity that all of you have. And of course, grateful to our beloved Swami for making all of this possible. So really, thank you for all you've done. Thank you for having me here today. So as Sister Anika mentioned, the title of this presentation is "Nature is the Best Teacher." And I wanted to, before we get into the topic of nature, I wanted to start by telling you a little bit about one of my best friends. And you'll kind of see why later on. This friend of mine, I've been out of New Zealand for a few months traveling, and I've really missed this dear friend who lives back at home. We usually hang out almost every day. We spend good quality time together. This is one of those friends that I can just pour my heart out to, and she's just such a good listener. You know, she doesn't come and give me advice. She doesn't try and solve my problems. She just listens with so much empathy and so much care and gently guides me to find my own answers. Whenever I share how I'm feeling with this friend, I just feel like everything is going to be okay. I feel calm. I feel relaxed. It's like the stress and worry just kind of goes away. One of those friends, you know? And she also helps me have a lot of fun. Sometimes I get a bit serious about all my work, and this friend gets me climbing in the park and playing, and brings out my inner child that many of you, you know, SSE children are probably well in touch with. She helps me keep it light. So I wanna, I'm gonna share my slides, and I'm gonna show you a picture of this dear friend. She'll be honored. This beautiful tree. So the story of this friendship is quite interesting. We actually started getting to know each other at the start of lockdown. And in New Zealand, when lockdown began, basically you could leave your house once a day to visit, you know, to walk in the neighborhood, unless you're buying, you know, groceries or going to the hospital. And so because we could leave the house once a day and you had to stay within a certain perimeter, there was basically one park we could visit from where we live in New Zealand. And so I ended up spending the full 1 hour that we were allowed in this park every day. Usually in the past, when I, you know, went out to exercise, I'd be walking very quickly or going for jogs or sometimes walking with a friend or a family member. But this time I used to walk alone and just spend time getting to know these trees. And I tell you, getting to know this one tree in particular was probably one of the highlights of the entire lockdown. I felt in this tree really Swami's presence. I felt in this tree so much love, so much guidance. Literally, as I said before, I could pour my heart out and somehow the wisdom would come, the answers would come, the care was felt. And I was wondering, why have I never spent time with trees before? You know, people are good friends, of course, but there's something about nature that's just so pure and peaceful and divine that I began to discover. And I began to sense and really appreciate more deeply for the first time just how close nature is to God. I wanted to share this quotation of Baba's. He says, "Nature is very close to God, closer than man is. For in man, there is a veil of ignorance clouding his vision and marring his sight. But nature is the purest handiwork of God. If you're able to love nature and feel in tune with it, you are that much closer to God. It is very easy to know God through nature. For in nature, there is goodness, simplicity, purity, and selflessness." And all of these I felt so much. I mean, you can feel it with any part of nature. I'm sure RMC feels it with his geckos and his pets. You know, you might feel it with the sun, the rainbows, all aspects. And for me, really spending time in the park and the tree kind of taught me these things. And spending time with this tree, I began to appreciate, you know, the kind of life I feel a lot of us young people live is very go, go, go. We're busy with school or university, sci center, work. And there's something so beautiful in witnessing the cycles that the trees are in. You know, in winter, they hibernate, they lose all their leaves. In summer, they're in full bloom. There's time for activity and there's time for stillness. And even just this very simple idea of let's follow rhythms. Let's really listen to our bodies and not just be go, 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 but really honor rest and really honor activity. It was a very simple lesson, but a very important lesson these trees taught me. They taught me the importance of stillness, of patience. You know, the buds they get only bloom when they're ready. You can't force the leaf to grow, the bud to bloom. Again, I feel as a young person, I can be quite restless, quite impatient, but yet being in these trees and nature, it inspires so much patience, so much stillness, just some of the beautiful values and qualities that God is. And I think what's so beautiful about nature is, you know, we have Swami's teachings. We're so lucky, as Uncle Siva said in the beginning, that we're the contemporaries of the Purnavatar. And we have all these amazing discourses. And one of the things Swami emphasizes is you can read my discourses, but you can also go out and experience my teachings. And I feel nature being so close to God, as Swami has said here, is like scriptures waiting to be discovered. It's like Swami's teachings waiting to be revealed to us. And it's so exciting because you're not just reading intellectually, but you can really discover the magnificence when we begin to look. I wanted to share a few quotations. There's so many that Swami has given of just the different kinds of things we can learn from nature. Before that, actually, these are a few pictures on how nature is a handiwork of God. So Swami says nature is the purest handiwork of God. These are just a few snowflakes. And some of you, I mean, you're probably much more familiar with snow than me being in Canada, but scientists have found that every snowflake is unique under a microscope. And it's just magnificent. You know, when you see nature, you can't deny the existence of the most creative, most beautiful, pure God. Flowers, I think, again, are just a beautiful manifestation of God's pure handiwork. Rainbows, another miracle, you know, such a miracle. This was a picture taken in Melbourne, in Australia. Even just the existence of the earth and the cosmos, you know, just an absolute miracle. We're perfectly positioned, floating in the middle of nowhere. And somehow all the conditions are perfectly conducive for light. Yeah, life. Anyone that's looked up at the stars, when you see the magnificence of the stars, the magnitude of the stars, even the ocean, you know, in this picture, but certainly the stars, it's so clear that, you know, we're small and part of a much bigger whole. You can really feel Swami's presence. And as I mentioned before, in all of this, they're just filled with so many teachings for us. A few. The bird takes no thought for it. Oh, the top of the screen is the bird takes no thought for itself. It's content to live on for tomorrow, content to live on what they can get. They teach man the lesson of contentment and indifference to the future. So it's always present, always living in the moment. The axe ruthlessly chops the sandalwood tree, but the sandalwood tree, without any malice or anger, leaves its fragrance on the axe. You know, amazing. We as humans, it's crazy the kind of deforestation that's happening. And in spite of being chopped down, the sandalwood tree responds with love. You know, in spite of such a harsh act, it leaves its fragrance on the axe. You know, beautiful lesson that we can respond, you know, to conflict, to hardness with love and with kindness. Learn a lesson from the insignificant ant, says Swami. When an ant spots a lump of sugar, it does not hide the fact and seek to consume it all alone. Instead, it runs to the nest to collect its friends and kinsmen, for it loves to share with others the feast it has come upon. What is shared is tastier. What is held back is bitter stuff. Life is short and full of misery, so do all you can to derive joy from making others happy. If others are miserable, how can you really be happy? And I had this experience just a couple of weeks ago. I was in India and I hadn't cleaned up properly. There were some crumbs on the table. And I came back and I found so many ants. There were literally hundreds of ants eating this crumb, you know, and a long trail of ants. And, it, you know, part of me was like, Swami, come on. I need to clear up these ants now. I mean, I learned my lesson to keep things clean. But at the same time, it was so clear, you know, like any of you have been in this position will know there's never just one ant eating away on its own. All the friends, all the family are there. And it's just such a simple but very profound teaching of the importance of sharing, which the humble ant can teach us. Swami says, the world is a great teacher, a constant guide and source of inspiration. Every bird, animal, tree, mountain, star, and even each tiny, tiny worm has a lesson for man if he has but the thirst to learn. And I think if we just have a little bit of humility and openness and start looking to the different creatures around us, there are just so many things we can learn. So I thought maybe we can, rather than listen to me, have a go at kind of putting this into practice. And so I'm going to invite you to do a little exercise and basically take a few moments to choose an aspect of nature that you want to learn from. And if you can bring this, maybe you can take a minute and see if there's anything around the space you're in. Maybe you've got a little stone, a leaf, a stick, maybe a fruit, a plant. Maybe there's a plant in your home. You can even choose a part of your body. You know, bodies are nature. You can choose a fingernail, a hair. You could choose an aspect of the weather. You know, if you don't have anything to bring, you could choose the rain, the sun, the clouds. Best if you can even see it or feel it. But just take a moment. I'll give you, you know, a few 30 seconds or so just to pick an aspect of nature that, you know, you're close to or that comes to mind. Could be a pet even, and something that you want to learn from for this exercise. So hopefully all of you have thought of something or got something or picked up something or can see something in your room, in your home. And so the invitation now is just to maybe take a few breaths and just settle yourself. If you've got something that you can hold, you can really acknowledge and look at how it feels, the textures. If you can see it, just pay attention to the different colors. If it's something you can't see, you could maybe close your eyes and just bring it to your mind's eye and really see if you can connect with this beautiful kind of piece of nature that you've chosen, this piece of creation of pure handiwork from Swami. And with your heart, you know, ask sincerely this little object, what wisdom do you have to offer me? What teaching do you have for me? And just paying attention to whatever you've chosen, there are infinite lessons in all of nature, Swami. So just see what comes up in your heart and mind. See what intrigues you. See what, yeah, lesson might arise. And we'll give you a couple of minutes to do this. And if you feel comfortable to do so, we'd love for you to also share in the chat box some of the things you're learning. If you've got a couple of points, a sentence, feel free just to share in the chat. You know, this is what I've learned from this aspect of nature I've chosen. Beautiful. So we've got sun does not differentiate. Sun provides growth for all. Beautiful. The rain teaches us to let go of all the negative thoughts we have in our minds so that we can be as happy as the sun. Beautiful. I see serenity in many aspects of nature, especially in a still lake. The sky, be open to whatever may come. Beautiful. The rock in my hand is happy and strong in its own shape. Doesn't want to mold to any form. Beautiful. Really accepting ourselves as we are. Plant, I never learned to stop growing. Trees help everyone. Trees to grow no matter the challenges. The sun as it gives oxygen, important for trees. Flower selflessly radiates fragrance and beauty without anything, expecting anything. Snowflakes teaches us each person is unique and appreciate those differences. Got more around trees and plants, oxygen, the sun, lotus flower, zucchini, beautiful examples coming through. Mother Earth teaches us to forgive. That's so beautiful. How much, you know, harm we inflict on our Mother Earth and how she teaches us, how she forgives everything. Vegetables, plants in my garden brings me alive whenever I'm working in the garden. Beautiful. There is a path near a park near where there that is full of trees and a lake. There are lots of houses and I feel very calm. Beautiful. Joy to flow like water, to not be rigid, to change. Beautiful. I learned that stepping on an ant gives joy to you, but sadness and anger to the ants. Empathy. Yeah, beautiful lessons. And we can see, you know, there's really an infinite number of values, of lessons, of guidance in life that we can seek from nature. So I guess the invitation is let's all continue, you know, really applying what Swami has encouraged us to do and spending time in nature, listening to her. All the wisdom is there. I wanted to share with you, going back to this beautiful friend of mine, that I'm clearly quite passionate about, one of the most beautiful lessons that she has taught me. And this came in the form of a poem. I'm not a poet at all. I don't even, but these words came one day when sitting in this tree, and I wanted to read them to you. Just give me one moment. I'm just gonna stop screen sharing and I'll pull it back up in a second. So this poem is titled, "I Am You and You Are Me." And you can close your eyes and listen to it if you like, or you can leave your eyes open, bring to your mind's eye a beautiful tree. My beloved tree, I am beginning to see that I am you and you are me. The air that enlivens this body is the very breath that pulses through your leaves. The water surging through your roots up your trunk flows through my blood. The fruits you bear are verily my skin, my bone, my body. So what makes you you and me me? They say the skin, or in your case bark, separates us, defines the boundaries between you and me. But you know what? I think our skin connects us. Rather than a boundary between two things, perhaps it's merely a line in the tapestry, a mark in the same sand that we're both a part of. The skin is the portal through which I experience you, I feel you. If anything, rather than separating, it connects us. And just as your peace extends far beyond your bark, your trunk, into the atmosphere and into my being, so too my presence extends far beyond the skin, touching you too. So why then do we carve arbitrary lines for where you end and where I begin? Just as a drop falling into a lake sends its ripples to every corner with no other droplet escaping its touch, so too does every thought, word, feeling, and deed from this being touch all others in the intricate web of life. Is there any difference really between one drop and next? Can one ripple be distinguished from another? And for what ends? For you are me and I am you, waves in the same ocean, ripples in the one lake, sand on the same shore, threads on the one tapestry. beloved tree, I have come to see that I am you and you are me. And this I felt was one of the most beautiful lessons that this tree imparted, that we are nature. You know, somehow in our society, we have this idea that we're humans superior to nature, separate to nature. Nature's this resource that we extract and we use, you know. The mountain becomes something to be conquered. The bird becomes a science project. You know, we see nature as this resource that we can use to make money. And the reality is our bodies are nature, you know. Our bodies verily are. What's really different? Externally, we're nature, and internally, it's the same Swami that enlivens us both. So really, is there a difference? And, you know, Swami says the Panchabhutas, the five elements, are the building blocks of life. You know, you'll be familiar with this: fire, water, air, ether, earth. And what's amazing is, if you think about this, the elements that are outside are the elements that are in our body. I want you to invite you just to maybe take a couple of deep breaths. Close your eyes, take a nice deep breath in and out. Another breath in and out. And this time, as you breathe in, just contemplate, where is the air coming from that you're breathing? Every moment we're breathing, usually we're not even aware of it. Where does this air come from? Well, some of us, well, a lot of the air comes from the trees, right? You know, trees turn carbon dioxide into oxygen. Actually, 75% of the air we breathe comes from the oceans. Phytoplankton in the oceans produce oxygen, which actually is the air that we breathe. So in a way, we're breathing the oceans. You know, it's amazing. The oceans are, and the air that comes from them, are very much in us. The water that's, you know, 70% of us is water. It's the same water that's in the lakes and the streams and the oceans. You know, the food we eat becomes our skin and bone. You know, I was thinking this morning, you know, what have you had for lunch today? The rice, the vegetables, the bread, the salad, whatever that might have been, like, that digests and actually becomes our bodies. So in a very real way, like, our bodies are nature. We're not separate from nature. We are nature. So if nature externally is polluted, our bodies are polluted. If the air is polluted, we're polluted. You know, if the water is dirty, that's dirty water in our system. If the soil is filled with toxins, those toxins are in the vegetables that we eat. And so we cannot be well if nature is not well. And similarly, if we are off balance, nature is off balance. And that's really what's happened to the world, right? We've become, as a society, so materialistic, so greedy. You know, nature is enough for man's need, not enough for man's greed, as Gandhi has said. And because we've lost our balance, nature in turn has lost her balance. And we see this in so many ways. I'm sure many of you are very familiar with these kinds of stats. I won't go through all of them, but there's so many deaths we see from environmental reasons these days, from air pollution, from contaminated water. You know, many of you will know, with climate change, global temperatures are rising. We're trying to, you know, attain them to 1.5 degrees. But at the rate that we're consuming and living, global temperatures will increase by 4 degrees by 2100, which is huge. You know, already beautiful Great Barrier Reef is an amazing coral reef close to home. It's in Australia. Most of it's been wiped out. Coral bleaching means most of the coral is pretty much dead. You know? So the impacts are already felt of climate change. 60% of all animal species have been wiped out since 1970. That's mind-boggling. You think, you know, we're one species. There are thousands, millions of species of nature, and 60% of animals we've wiped out, you know, through our deforestation efforts and other efforts. 13 million tons of plastic waste. So it's clear that Mother Earth is off balance. We're feeling the impacts of that in natural disasters, you know, fires and floods, a host of natural disasters. And we need to restore this balance. We need to find this balance again. As I mentioned earlier, materialism and consumption is a big part of this. And there's a project called the Earth Overshoot Project, which looks at kind of the rates of consumption in different parts of the world and how this is affecting our Earth. And what they found is, if everyone lived like the average Canadian, we would need 5.1 Earths to sustain humanity. It's a similar stat for New Zealand, the US. I think it's almost double this for some of the Middle Eastern countries. But basically, most of us, the kind of lives we're living is too much. Like, the Earth cannot sustain us. 5.1 Earths is not sustainable. We don't have 5.1 Earths. And I mean, Swami is just the most beautiful model in this way, right? Like, he barely owned a few pieces of clothes. He lived in such a small space. He lived so humbly, did not waste a drop of water, did not have anything more than, you know, such a simple life. compared to kind of what most of us live in most of our societies. And so really there's a big need for us to all practice healing on desires, consume less, have less, you know, minimize the, you know, rethink the kind of food we eat, the clothes we buy, travel, transport, every aspect of our life really needs to be rethought to bring our earth back into balance. I think one of the key things to really do this is to have love for nature. You know, there's thousands of tips out there in terms of how we live sustainably. That's actually the easy part. You can research, you know, what material, okay, organic, this is better, or, you know, what foods are seasonal. We can learn that. But if we don't have love for nature, it's really hard. Without love for nature, acting sustainably can feel like a sacrifice. Why should I shorten my shower? It's just enjoyable in the cold winter to have a long, hot shower. But when we really love nature, when we care for her, when we respect her, when we feel she's our mother, you know, we need to care for her, when we really feel that love and that respect, it becomes really easy to live sustainably. We're willing to sacrifice. Sacrifice is a very easy thing for a parent that loves their child. They don't think twice about it. And similarly, the more we grow our love for nature, my experience is it becomes very easy to buy less, to have less, to put in the greater effort to do that research to find a more sustainable option. And I think as our love for nature grows, we begin to take more responsibility for all of our actions. One of the interesting things that some of you may be quite familiar with is the idea of a hidden cost. You know, in our society that we live in today, we're so disconnected to where our food comes from, where our products come from, where our clothes come from, how they're grown, the amount of energy required to grow and produce anything. And just one example is, you know, the water footprint for cotton is enormous. Cotton is actually one of the best materials we can buy. It's better than polyesters that are made, you know, from oil and much more polluting. But even in cotton, you know, you need more than 2,600 liters of water for just one shirt. Yeah, 2,600 liters. And this is a 750 milliliter bottle. Yeah, 2,000 liters is mind-boggling for one shirt. And this goes for anything, you know. By choosing to produce, you know, consume more dairy products, that requires a huge amount of land and water and energy. And so if we think about everything we buy as a cost, Mother Nature, Mother Earth is paying for this, we'd then have to just be really conscious, like, do I need that shirt? You know, if I need to buy it, can I buy something really high quality, you know, really sustainable that will last a long time? When it tears, am I able to repair it? How do I make what I have last as long as possible? And live with the awareness that all of this is has a cost and a consequence. And how might I minimize my footprint and really in that way help love and care and restore the balance in nature? I think one of the most beautiful things that can help us practice this and live this love for nature is having gratitude. And I wanted to share this quotation from our Swami. He says, "You have to show your gratitude to God for the benefit showered on you. Consider, for instance, how the divine has filled the atmosphere with life-giving oxygen to enable you to live. The biggest fan made by man can provide breeze only for a small area, but the winds caused by nature can blow over the whole world. Who is the cause of this wind? There are three kinds of lamps in the temple. They illumine a small space, but the sun created by God illumines the whole world. We pump water with the help of pump sets. Can all the water pumped by these sets equal a fraction of the water got from a heavy downpour of rain, which can inundate the Ganges?" So it's very clear that nature provides everything for us, the air we breathe, the water we drink, the food we eat, the clothes we wear. She enables, sustains, nurtures us like a mother. She is our mother, as Swami has told us. And the more we can offer our gratitude, the more we can really feel, wow, thank you, Mother Nature. Not to see her as a resource, something that we're entitled to, but really as a gift that God has given us, the more we can grow in this love, grow in this gratitude, and as a consequence, really live in a way that's much more harmonious. So this almost brings us to the close, but before we wrap up, I wanted to invite you just to take a moment, just to consider in this point, in this moment, what are you feeling really grateful to Mother Nature for? And again, invite you to share this in the chat box. It could be anything. It could be simple. It could be, you know, the lunch you ate today that was grown in her land and watered by her waters, you know, could be the clothes you're wearing, anything, the inspiration that the pets, the love the pets give you. Just take a moment to share in the chat something that you feel grateful to Mother Nature for. And on this note of gratitude, we can come together and close really thanking Swami for the opportunity to be here together, thanking Mother Sai for her manifestation as Bhumi Devi, you know, Mother Earth, for all that she gives us, for the wisdom, the inspiration, the love, the care, the resources, the food. And really wanted to thank you for your beautiful participation. Wish you all the best. I hope as you continue, you know, as SSE students, as young adults, that nature continues to be a source of inspiration that you find and can connect to Swami's teachings through all the teachers present in your life. And thank you once again for having me. I'll just see a few of the comments that are coming through, and then we'll wrap up. So the beautiful sun, the roses in our gardens, the resilience in bearing us, nature gives us food, the sun, the oxygen, makes me calm if I'm angry, thankful for water, fresh air, carrying my weight on a daily basis, beautiful, teaching me how to give, not expecting anything in return. Thank you. Feel free to continue sharing, and thank you all for having me. Jai Sairam.
Thank you, Sister Shruti, for such a fantastic presentation. Now, we're going to play a short game of Kahoot to test how attentive we were listening to Sister Shruti. Sister Daniela, podium is yours.
Thank you so much, Sairam, everyone. And thank you so much, dear Sister Shruti, because that was a very enlightening and beautiful presentation. Before I continue, parents, I lovingly request that you please rename the device that your child is using with name and group number. So if you can take a moment to please do that while I share the Kahoot. All right, so I hope you can all see that on your screen. What I'm going to do is ask you to please join us at www.kahoot.it. I'll post that in the chat. So hopefully you're seeing that. And the PIN is 4757811. So once again, I'll type that in the chat. So please do join us in the chat. Please do join us in the Kahoot. Whenever you're ready, I'll give you a minute so that we can get started. It's a very short 4-item Kahoot. Let's see how much you know, how much you can remember of this talk.
I think some of the children are looking for the link in the...
There's the link once again. And then here I'll post this in case it didn't make it. So there's the link, www.kahoot.it. And the PIN, 4757811.
I keep joining, but it's not appearing on the screen.
It doesn't appear. Okay. Oh, there. Okay. Great. Great. I'm seeing you joined. Fantastic. All right, we've got 35, 37. Excellent. Fabulous. Thank you. I'll wait a couple more seconds and I'm going to get started. Okay, we're up to 50. So if you didn't get a chance to join, please note that at the bottom of the right-hand corner, the pin will be there. So let's start. Nature is the best teacher. 2-1, let's go with our first question. If everyone lived like the average Canadian, how many Earths would we need to sustain humanity? Is it 1.2, 3, 5.1, or 6.5? Excellent. So many of you remembered. It is 5.1, a very, very surprising and scary statistic. So let's change it. Let's make it better. Second item, at our current rate of consumption, global temperatures will increase by how much in 2100? Is it 1.5 degrees, 2, 3, or 4 degrees? Yes, you're right. It's 4 degrees. Again, something we can definitely work on. Great job, everyone. Now our third question, Which of the following is false? Is it that humans are a part of nature, humans have rights over nature, humans are nature, or humans are the children of nature? You got it. Yeah, we don't have rights over nature. We're part of nature. And for our last question, what does Satya Sai Baba say that we can learn from ants? Is it sharing what we have with others, self-confidence and strength, cooperation, or living in the present? Excellent, sharing what we have with others. So let's go to our winners. In third place, we have Sunita. Great job. Second place, Ashrita. And first place, Sachin. Wow, fabulous. And our runners up are Vijay Sai and Somesh. Great job, everyone. Give yourselves a round of applause. Back to you, Sister Anika.
I think I'm going to pass it over to my co-MC, Brother Kishore.
Hi, Ram. Thanks, everyone, for playing Kahoot. Hopefully that was really fun. I'm sure. I know I love Kahoot just not only because of the game, but also because of the music, too. So I hope everyone enjoyed that amazing game led by Sister Daniela. Okay, so at this time, we're going to be shifting gears and moving to breakout room activities. So breakout rooms will be occurring from 12:40 to 1:30 p.m. Eastern Time, which is 9:40 to 10:30 a.m. for those of us on the West Coast. All children are able to participate in the breakout room activities, as we have activities arranged for all participants ranging from those in pre-SSE to those in Group 4. Parents, again, please make sure that your child is named according to the proper naming convention, which is the child's first name, last name, and then the group number, so we know where to assign your child. And then once your child is in a breakout room, parents, you're more than welcome to take a break. However, please make sure that your child is in the breakout room before stepping away. And then after we complete the breakout room activities, we'll be taking a short break. So hopefully once everyone has made sure that they are our naming conventions are right, we'll begin to open up the breakout rooms for breakout room activities.